When you think of dinosaur documentaries, you tend to think of rich amounts of information conveyed to you by a British narrator with a creamy golden voice over beautifully animated CGI dinosaurs. But while these documentaries are gold mines of info for dino lovers, to the general public they must seem like nonsensical drivel. All of these documentaries seem to just be the same, with named and famous paleontologists speaking, then cut to dinosaur, then transition shot, then back to paleontologist. Surely all dinosaur documentaries are like this, right? Well, obviously, you've never heard of Jurassic Fight Club! Yeah, boy! Jurassic Fight Club. This is the most brain-dead and inaccurate dinosaur documentary ever made. There is nothing about this documentary series that you can compliment it for. Nothing. Any good thing is either basic information or pure 100% coincidence. But I want to be fair, so let's go over what good things this series has. Okay, let's see. The narrator has a cool voice. The animation, the CGI still looks really good. It's very impressive. Okay, what else is there? Oh, that's right, there's also the fight scene! Other dinosaur documentaries may have facts and accurate dinosaurs, but do they have a scientifically inaccurate T-Rex fight a smaller T-Rex after the smaller T-Rex fought the scientifically inaccurate T-Rex's two children? Wait, didn't the documentary call that a nanotyrannus? We'll get to that in a second, but yes, the only reason I would recommend anyone watch this documentary is these dumb fights. Most of which, let's be honest, are rather basic, but you know, you get some bangers every so often. I mean, the fights are not accurate, but like I told you, nothing here is accurate. Alright, now that I've given this documentary its, fair chance, it's now time to roast this thing like a turkey on Thanksgiving. You roast turkeys, right? Sometimes you cook them, but typically you're supposed to roast them, no? Nah, forget it. We're gonna cook this thing like a turkey on them. You know what? It's ruined. Joke went on for too long. Now it's ruined. I could go over everything the documentary does that is bad, but I think it'll be much simpler if I just take the first episode, because this episode exemplifies every problem this series has.
A pair of adult T-Rexes are on the hunt. They must leave their babies unguarded.
Now, dinosaur nerds will know that this is wrong, but after some extensive research and hard work, and by hard work I mean I went to the first page of Google, and then went past the first page of Google. I can see that the oldest articles talking about this are from 2011, and this aired in 2008, so, no, stop. While the oldest article I could find was in 2011, I want to tell you three things. One, this information was discovered earlier than that. I just didn't find an article because I'm lazy. 2. Articles about this piece of information are rehashed every year, month, and if I looked hard enough, probably every week, because mainstream media does not comprehend that there are other dinosaurs than the T-Rex. Unless a new dinosaur is found in any non-science exclusive newspaper, all dinosaur mentions are T-Rex, 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 new dino? Don't believe me? Check for yourself. Pick a newspaper, search for all articles that are about dinosaurs, and I'll prove it to you. And 3rd, does anyone know Prehistoric Park? I love this show. It came out in 2006 and was amazing, with great CG dinosaurs and a fantastic setting and premise. I hope they make a remake one day, but if it doesn't star Nigel Marvin like before, I will riot and burn the studio to the ground. The first episode, Nigel goes back in time to find some T-Rexes for the park. Wait a minute, are those T-Rexes hunting in packs? And are those T-Rexes that we did not previously see in the previous shot staying with T-Rexes that appear to be smaller? Is this my point? Yes. However, after some more researching, I should make sure everyone knows that this is not 100% certain what T-Rexes did with their young. It could go either way. This video is also supposed to be funny. So again, do your own research as well. Again, I have done research, but I just want to make sure everyone knows I could not find a definitive yes or no answer. Just wanted to make sure that everyone knows this. Okay. Good. And this show came out in 2006, 2 years before Jurassic Fight Club? That's right, baby. I didn't forget about what video I was making. This is what we in showbiz like to call setting up a point and then leaving to talk about something completely unrelated, only to actually make the thing related to the original point. We should probably shorten this somehow. Okay, so we got false information in the first 12 seconds. Not looking very promising.
Leaving their young is a very risky thing. They understand that there's dangers out there.
Check out this Chad right here. Dinosaur George. Dude, he's a paleontology expert at that university. It's not listed, but come on, guys. It's Dino George. Everyone knows Dino George. He's a real paleontology expert. What's his degree? Where does he work?
The adults have left a series of scent marks. They outline boundaries for the juveniles to stay within and for all other dinosaurs to keep out.
Most likely, T-Rex did mark its territories with scent markers, as many animals in modern day do this, including dogs and cats. There are multiple ways to create scent markings, mostly by depositing strong-smelling substances that can be found in urine, feces, or made from specialized organs. There's no way to see if these dinosaurs had these organs, so it is largely inconclusive, but definitely not impossible. So that's a point for the episode.
But one dinosaur in particular uses these scent marks as a homing device. Nanotyrannus actively hunts and kills young Tyrannosauruses. Not to eat, but to get rid of the competition.
What? What? Where the hell did you get this information? Was it you, George? Come on, you should know better than this. I'm starting to think maybe you're not a paleontology expert. There are animals that hunt purely for sport, as well as something known as surplus killing, which an animal usually does to either store up food for later, such as weasels, which surplus kill voles, and then bury them to eat later in the winter, when it's too cold to hunt. Or bears that will surplus kill unborn salmon because of their higher muscle quality and high energy parts, including the brain and eggs. Most times, surplus killing is to have stored food, food to bring the offspring, and also to allow the animal to get better hunting experience. However, surplus killing has never been documented to be for sport. As I said, there are animals that hunt for sport, such as orcas, stoats, hyenas, and a case of two Kenyan lions hunting and slaughtering 28 to 135 people in just 10 months. Luckily, the lions were eventually shot and killed by a man named John H. Patterson. The killed people were never eaten, just mauled. The lions are currently available on display as they were stuffed after being killed. Scientists are not sure why the lions went on a hunting spree, but some say it may have been sport killings to test new flavors, as the beast's stomach were filled with a wide assortment of different animals. Or perhaps a finning of prey animals or territorial disputes led to the lions hunting the humans. However, this does not explain why the human bodies were hardly eaten. So could a nanotyrannus hunt juvenile T-Rexes for sport? Possibly, but listen carefully to what Dino George here says.
But one dinosaur in particular uses these scent marks as a homing device. Nanotyrannus actively hunts and kills young Tyrannosauruses. Not to eat, but to get rid of the competition.
That's right, people. It is not a single nanotyrannus that went on a sport kill, but rather an instinctual desire for the whole species. Mama Nano raised her offspring to intentionally target the biggest predator in the region. Again, not for food, but to get rid of the competition.
Doesn't just haphazardly attack. These young tyrannosaurs have a special defensive mechanism, a mouth full of bacteria. The nanotyrannus knows that a nip from a young tyrannosaur could potentially end its life.
This information is based off a hypothesis from William L. Abler's publicated essay called The Teeth of the Tyrannosaurs. He got to this hypothesis through seeing deep marks in the serrations of the T-Rex's teeth. He says that these marks could have been pieces of bacteria-laden carcasses from T-Rex's earlier meals. Every time you got bit by a T-Rex, the bacteria carcass would rub onto your wounds caused by the teeth and give you an infection. However, it would take a long time for an infection to kill the dinosaur, and through a fossil record of an Edmontosaurus that survived a T-Rex bite, we know that it's not impossible to survive a T-Rex's bite.
These are the first animals to use biological weapons.
After some research, this does fall under the definition of a bioweapon, if it did have the ability to infect you with a bite. As for its claim that these are the first, I have found no evidence to support for or against this piece of information. Our articles simply state that it may have had an infectious or septic bite. May, again, being the key word. How strong is it that Nano's head is not only able to knock down a juvenile T-Rex, something that at age 2 would weigh 29 kilograms, and at age 14, the age of a juvenile, which is what the show refers to these two being, would weigh 1,800 kilograms, without harming its skull in any way? Not even a concussion, a headache. May I remind you that an Allosaurus was a dinosaur with a head that was extremely dense and protected of the brain, because it hunted by hitting small dinosaurs with its head. This thing, by the way, not a carnivorous dinosaur that weighs a fully grown one by 800 kilograms at around age 14.
The Nano grabs the young Tyrannosaurus Rex behind the neck, picks him up, and throws him like a ragdoll across the forest floor.
And then you expect me to believe a dinosaur not so much bigger than this T-Rex, which again weighs 1,800 kilograms, was then able to pick it up and throw it that hard at that range with such ease. Yeah, right.
He looks down, and there is the second juvenile T-Rex. The Nanotyrannus on the leg.
This time, Nanotyrannus will make sure that the T-Rex dies. Flexing all the power of his jaws, he clamps down with nearly half a ton of pressure and crushes its spinal cord.
He throws it to the ground, and using his foot claw, he stomps the baby.
But there's no time to eat. One T-Rex down, Nanotyrannus moves.
Dude, what the complained a minute ago about this, and the thing is holding it in its mouth above the ground with it squirming everywhere, and it's not even trying. It's like the thing weighs 0 pounds. I flinch every time my turtle kicks its feet into my head. You expect me to believe that an 1,800 kilogram animal is able to be lifted around like that as if it's made out of Plato? How did I believe anything this documentary said?
Kill.
Okay, so a contradiction and more unrealistic physics. Fun fact, before the creation of this series, physics and the laws of the universe were involved in a double kidnapping, and as such, the laws of reality crumbled, and that's why nothing makes sense here. Luckily, Dino George was there, and he took them to the university and sent his pet raptors to eat the kidnappers.
As he leans down to take a bite, he feels the ground begin to vibrate.
That something big is the adult female T-Rex returning from her hunt.
The Nanotyrannus can identify the animal that produced the scent markings through its smell. Wouldn't it just smell the Tyrannosaurus coming? Maybe the scent markers overpowered it and confused it. The smell is apparently rather overpowering.
As he leans down to take a bite, he feels the ground begin to vibrate.
Okay, and now the baby just stood up like nothing happened despite it spinning in the air and hitting the ground like 10 seconds ago, but I just don't care anymore and I won't bring it up again. Also, where's the other T-Rex? You could say that the Nanotyrannus only required one T-Rex, which it does, but the adults don't know what's attacking the juveniles at all. It could have been another T-Rex, a pack of those raptors we saw at the beginning. Ah, but you see, the baby was actually using the secret Nanotyrannus is attacking me and my brother, cry of pain. Despite the narrator saying that the babies have never seen a Nanotyrannus before, I'm going to use this as my headcanon from now, and you can't convince me otherwise.
Now the Nanotyrannus has two options. Try to finish off the remaining juvenile Tyrannosaurus Rex, or turn around and run.
Run. It's going to run. Why else would it do anything else? There is no reason for it to stay at all. If this was a real animal, which it's not, the second the mom shows up, the fingers have booked it and left running like a roadrunner dust cloud. What?
It decides to pit its speed and agility against the strength of a mad Tyrannosaurus Rex.
Is the dumbest dino I've ever seen. Guy has half-chewed leg and is facing down an angry mother T-Rex.
But Nanotyrannus underestimates his opponent.
The last thing he sees are the open jaws of the female Tyrannosaurus Rex.
Hold it!
She grabs the Nanotyrannus in her mouth. And using the bite force of 1,000 pounds per square inch, she crushes the back, crushes the ribs, and ends the life of this attacker.
That is 1/12 of the actual amount of bite force, but maybe it was a deliberate choice by the mother T-Rex.
Nanotyrannus and T-Rex, because they're in Western North America, they may have...
Holy moly, someone we can identify the workplace of! And he has a specialized field of work! How does it feel, Dr. Holtz, being the only identifiable scientist in this documentary? No disrespect to Dino George. And that's the end of the episode. Overall, I think it was bad. The fight scenes were entertaining, but as I said, very stupid, and as we've seen, very illogical. It also took me 2 days to find somewhere I could watch this f***ing show before I eventually found it on the iTunes store. The facts of this documentary are often false or outdated, and it feels wrong to even call it a documentary. If you must watch it, search it up on YouTube where all the fight scenes are available to be seen in a crisp 360... Wait, what? Wait, that's supposed to be 720? Are you sure? Yes? Okay, 720. Can't tell by looking at it. Well, that's not all the documentary. I just skipped to the end because, one, the episode is 44 minutes long, and I covered about 10 minutes of it in total. Again, do not watch this. If you want to, it's $2 on iTunes. I think I covered the inaccuracies and falsities and even the actual facts that are true, but I also believe that Nanotyrannus isn't a real dinosaur, and by believe, I mean it isn't a real dinosaur. Yeah, it's not a real dinosaur. During the time this was being made, scientists were not still 100% sure, but now it is confirmed. I didn't have to do any of this. I could have just said that Nanotyrannus is actually just a juvenile T-Rex, and all of this would have been done in 2 minutes. Anyways, if you like this video, then subscribe. I'll probably make something similar to this in 4 weeks. I have science videos, stop motion reviews of documentaries like this one. Woo! Go watch this one too, or don't. I make other things as well, like animations, but they're really bad. So instead of doing that, just go subscribe to me. Turn on notifications as well. This is Dr. Plague. I will be signing out.